amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing. So amazing.
So amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
You cause the sun that will just shine. I'm so glad you're mine. Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine. Tip joints.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
Sure, you're amazing. You're so amazing.
So amazing.
Tell me you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shall you're amazing.
Tell
me you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're so amazing.
So amazing.
You heal the
sick.
Raise the dead. You Lord of all.
Great I am.
You call the sun, the star to shine. I'm glad to say you're mine. Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine. We stand in love with you.
All
you see
the
grace and the danger. Somebody say you're holy,
you're
worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb.
For me.
Say
we
stand
on you.
Shall
obey.
Somebody
see your holy.
Your
holy.
For me.
Now do you pray
me
to put your hands together like this? Open your mouth and exalt your King in here. Can you give God the praise in here? If the Lord has done anything for you, somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody say, Lord, you are there. We came together, together at the time no one was best to you, Father.
Say no one cares.
No one cares to you.
Somebody tell the Lord.
Say no one cares.
No one cares to you.
See, I can cross this globe and find no one.
No one cares to you.
Can you look to heaven tonight?
Say, your remains.
Your remains.
Your remains.
Your remains.
See, no one compares.
No one cares to you.
There's no one who even comes close to you.
No one cares to you.
See, can't nobody hold me like you can.
No one cares to you.
Can you help us sing this tonight? Say,
you're amazing.
Tell me you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Get up, you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout me, you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Tell me you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You've been so good to me.
You're amazing.
And you've been so great to me.
You're amazing.
Shout me, you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout me, you're amazing.
You're amazing.
And you look back over your life.
Amazing.
And see what he brought you through. And see where he's taking you to.
Amazing.
We say you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Boy, you're my keeper.
You're
my deliverer.
You're
my way maker.
You're
and you're my sustainer.
You're
in the midnight hour.
You're
amazing. In the midnight hour.
You're amazing.
In the midnight hour.
You're amazing.
We say you're amazing. You've been so good to me. We say you're amazing. Shout you're amazing. Shout you're amazing. Jesus wins. He went to Calvary to save a wretch.
Like
you and me.
They
hold him tonight. And they stretch him wide. He holds his hand. For you and me,
tonight,
that's the story.
Because
every night, he rolls with the power, the healing power, the saving power.
They
say you're amazing.
They
say you're amazing.
Your name.
Your name.
Your name.
Your name.
All right. So anyway, my drummer came to me and said, sing this scripture. And then the scripture was Proverbs 3. And I just looked at it, and then I started going, said, we will write them all down. Ooh, I see y'all be on Instagram, huh? Y'all be... So we really ought to write. Okay, let us sing the song, all right? Come on, let's go for it. We gotta find some energy. Come on.
He who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. I am the way, the truth and the light. No one gets to the Father except that he comes through me. Yeah. So let not mercy and truth say forsake you. Let not mercy and truth. We say forsake.
Picture and imagine going from living paycheck to paycheck to making six figures a month running a Christ-centered business that's focused on building.
And because you have the word in your heart, you can do that. No more commercials. Hallelujah. No more. Don't even try it. Thank you, Lord.
You got it. Come on. Trust it.
Thank you. God bless you. I just wanted to let that play for a little bit, man, because that's that right there, that's some serious smooth jazz. With this backdrop I got, my God, I see myself and my wife. Yes, sir! Oh, God bless you. This is your radio host, Bishop J. Charles Carrington, Jr., the senior pastor of Life Builders Church, and welcome to this edition of Midday Manna. Please allow me to say to you that Midday Manna is a streaming ministry of the Life Builders Church here in Baltimore, and I am your radio host, and I adore the Lord, and I bless him for this opportunity to join you. Well, this is the second day of August. We are in the month of August, the eighth month of the year. Can you believe that we are in August? God have mercy. I remember January. I remember, my God, May, of course, the greatest month. I know some think that other months are, but other than January, May to me is the greatest month. To me, not to me. But I thank God for being here this eighth month, the second day of the eighth month. We are the second month of the third quarter. Can you all believe that? Can you believe that we are already in the third quarter? So, beloved, let's get about it. Can we pray? Father, in the name of Jesus, this is the day that you have made. We do rejoice, and we're glad in it. We're grateful for it. Lord, have your way today. Take us out of self. Use us for somebody else. Get the glory out of today's stream. Get today's glory, Lord God, and every day thereafter. Now, Lord, your name is God above all. Your name is worthy above praise and glory that man could give, but you accept it and you receive it, Lord, and you love us for it. And we definitely love you. Lord, we don't love you as much as you love us. We're not capable of loving you like that. But with every ability, every fiber of our existence, Lord, I declare, I love you. Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. And I thank you for today. Now have your way in this time that we spend together. Take us out of self. Use me for somebody else. This is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's hold up our Bibles, make our declaration. Let's declare together. Ready? Lord, I thank you. Come on, say it with me. Lord, I thank you that I have my Bible. It is my personal copy of basic instruction before leaving earth. It's my Bible. I am a believer, not a doubter. I'm not just a hearer, but I'm also a doer. And my life is most much the blessed because I hear and I obey the word of the living God. Father, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, giving me present clarity and future illumination. I hide your word in my heart that I won't sin against you. The Lord be glorified today. Have your way in this word. And Lord, I declare I'm intending to leave this experience much better than I came to it. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved, we are in August, and I am one that is intent on finishing this year strong, finishing it stronger than I entered in. God didn't give me this year to waste. Since it's gone so fast, I look back over it, and I ask God, please let me be able to testify that I've been productive. Beloved, there's a book that I want to share with you, a book that I wrote for this month of August. It is our special. This is not the final book. Beloved, I actually sold out of my copies of them. I wound up giving the last copy to my mother. So this is the manuscript. But you're not going to buy this on Amazon. There's a link with this stream that will get you to this book. 40-day journal, 40-day devotional. Consecrated life. 40-day devotional. Yes, 40 days. Nobody telling you got to fast 40 days. Nobody telling you that. But, beloved, it is a consecration book. It's a book that, beloved, is going to bless your life in a magnificent way, a magnanimous way. And I just want to be a blessing to you by offering it this month. It is a 5-star on Amazon. Several people bought it, loved it, commented on it, and I want to share it with you. Can I read a portion of the foreword? It says, I'm asking you to give me 10 to 20 minutes of your time every day for the next 40 days. Listen, the Lord has ordained that this time for you will be a time that we shed the experiences, realizations, and attitudes of losers and become winners. That's one thing we're doing at Life Builder Church. I've been dealing with Nehemiah in our morning prayer. I'll be dealing with it Sunday. What a powerful word about the rubbish that was left from past destruction and past experiences and how the enemy seeks to hide behind that rubbish. You want to catch that word Sunday, 10 a.m. live. If you can't make it live, beloved, we're going to be at Pikesville High School. Amen. If you can't make it, tune in online. But it's going to be a powerful word. But hear me, my goodness. You are spending time consecrating. To consecrate, one has decided to above norm, go hard after God in order to become better and be more productive. In other words, WIN. In this book, WIN is an acronym for walking in newness, according to 2 Corinthians 5:17. We are in Christ, the anointed one, and his accompanying anointing, Jesus. All things are passed away. And behold, all things are become new. 40. Let me get to this. Wow. The word or the number 40 is mentioned some 146 times in scripture. It is related to trials, testings, and probation. Wow. As we know, Jesus was led of the Holy Ghost into the wilderness, that he fasted 40 days. And 40 nights. And afterward, he was tempted by the devil. Jesus spoke of the destruction of Jerusalem by Romans that occurred 40 years after his resurrection, crucifixion, and resurrection. Moses had vital periods of his life experiences occur in 40-day increments. Y'all hear this now. Y'all be blessed and hear it. Moses had this going on in his life. 40-day increments Moses spent in the presence of God, and God dealt with him. 40 years a prince in Egypt, 40 years on the backside of the desert, and 40 years wandering with the children of Israel in the wilderness. Moses was on Mount Sinai 40 days and 40 nights when he received the Ten Commandments and the law. The 12 spies spied out Canaan 40 days. Come on. Elijah was on Mount Horeb for 40 days. Jonah took 40 days to preach to Nineveh. Ezekiel laid on his side 40 days, symbolizing Israel's sin. The number 40 is also related to prosperity, the product of 5, the number of grace, times 8, the number of new beginnings. 40 different authors wrote the Bible. Did you know that? Israel flourished as a united kingdom for 40 years under David. And 40 years under Solomon, David's son. Okay? I want you to get this because we're going to be going into a time of consecration before the year is up. And part of that time will be in this consecration journal. And I want you to spend with us. We go on a 20-day, 21-day consecration. But I want you to maybe start a little early if you've not done it before. Again, you don't have to fast 40 days and 40 nights. Some of you be crying, my head. I'm not making fun of you. I'm just saying that we have to toughen up a little bit because times of fasting are upon us and we need to be consecrated before God. So go on Amazon. Use the link in the comment section. Get this book. Get it. The 40-day consecration life building 40-day devotional. It will do you good. Lesson 9 is before us right now. Let's hit this word. Man, I'm excited about this word. And I woke up just thanking God for the opportunity to give it. And here we are. Look with me as we do lesson 9 of our discipleship class. And the topic of this lesson is the expectations of disciples. The expectation of disciples. Part 1. Look with me at Matthew 22, 36 through 40 from the Christian Standard Bible. Come on, let's go there. Matthew 22, 36 through 40 from the Christian Standard Bible. Let's read the words of Jesus. that he spoke to this question. Teacher, which command in the law is greater? He said to him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and most important command. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commandments. My brother has shared some wisdom with me that these two commandments are like what a baby would have hanging in their crib. And that mobile, I believe they call it, and it's hanging, and on one end of the mobile is love the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And on the other end of that mobile is love your neighbor as yourself. I like that revelation, because on all these two commandments hang all the law and prophets. You fulfill these two, you're in essence fulfilling all the law and the prophets. That's what Jesus was saying. He wasn't saying I'm come to end the law. He's saying I'm making it fulfillable. Love the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Do that, then you'll fulfill the other things that I've asked you to fulfill. Why am I talking about requirements and expectations? Because, beloved, every person that is a disciple, there's an expectation upon you. There's a requirement that you have, because a disciple is a disciplined one. Remember that? A disciple is one who is disciplined. Come on, don't lose that. When you are a disciple, you are disciplined to walk in the things of God. You're disciplined as a follower. You're disciplined as a believer. You follow the principles, the precepts, the examples of God, and you walk in the ways of God. Come on. So with that knowledge and understanding, I want you to receive this word that Jesus spoke, not just a suggestion, but to love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, okay? And then to love your neighbor as yourself. Let's also talk about the second expectation of disciples, and then we'll get into this lesson. Galatians 2:20, one of my favorite scriptures in all the word of God. All the Bible is my favorite, but I love Galatians 2:20, which declares the following. I have been crucified with Christ, and I'm reading from the NIV, the New International Version. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. But Christ lives in me. He energizes me. He invigorates me. He resuscitates me. He revives me. God have mercy. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That's Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Let's get into this word, because I want to quickly give you, and be thorough about it, what are the basic structural bones of a successful disciple of Jesus Christ? Every successful endeavor has to have a foundation. I remember one of the great hymns of the church that I must quote right now, The Solid Rock. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. That great hymn of the church represents our foundation as believers. It's bedded in Christ. It's standing on Christ, the solid rock. Oh my God, I feel the anointing in here. But I want us to understand that if something is to last, it must have foundation. And I must say to you as a believer, if you are to last, if you are to grow, if you are to be what God has called you to be, you must have foundation. So many people today want to jump from kindergarten to graduation. And that's not feasible. We are in a spiritual warfare, spiritual battle. We're not giving the devil credit. We're just making sure you understand. There is a devil out here trying to kill, steal, and destroy you. Kill you, steal from you, and destroy you. What is he trying to steal? Well, he knows we still have dominion. He wants to take your dominion from you, the dominion that God gave us to reign in this world. Satan is a liar. He's a defeated foe, and he's not taking my dominion. I'm not letting him have it. I'm not forfeiting it. I am not abdicating it. I have dominion. I have power over him. Jesus gave me power to tread on serpents and scorpions, to stand and to walk and to smash the devil's head. And I bruise my heel because I keep stomping until that head is flat and crushed. But that's what I do because I hate him with a perfect hatred. How can you hate anybody? I hate him because he first hated me. And he's not opposite God. He's not equal to God. But the devil is my adversary. He's trying to kill me, steal from me, and destroy me. And I know he hates me, but I hate him too. So I'm not going to give in to him. I'm not going to give up to him. The Bible said, give no place to the devil. So I must be a disciplined one so that I won't give Satan what he does not deserve. I don't give Satan what he should not have. The Bible says to me that I have been given power over the works of darkness. So I have to discipline myself as a disciple, learn of the ways of Jesus who whooped Satan's tail, so much so that he didn't come back for a long time until he entered into Judas and then began to do what he did and was entered into several others who interrupted Jesus often while he was preaching the gospel, but Jesus got the glory. God got the glory anyhow. But there must be a foundation. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? Please hear me. You must not skip process. You must gain foundation. Beloved, I've been in ministry the majority of my life. 45 years I have preached this glorious gospel. 45 actually plus years I have preached this gospel. A large part of that before I got in the pulpit was carrying my pastor, Monroe Randolph Saunders Sr., carrying his briefcase, picking the trash up off the floor, fixing tea for guests that were preaching at the church, ushering in and carrying the briefcase of visiting preachers and being told to get out the room and we'll call you when I'm ready. Not mean or harsh. Bishop Saunders was not harsh, but you know, giants and generals were talking. Me, a private at the time, didn't have right to be privy to that conversation. So I waited out the door humbly. I stood there until they came out. Feet hurt? Yeah, sometimes them shoes was tight. Sometimes I couldn't afford the leather. I got the pleather, but this is a different day. I don't wear pleather. The pleather don't touch my feet. It hurts. I hate them shoes sometimes. But anyway, I ain't talking about shoes. But beloved, I served before I preached the gospel. I had to learn how to be humble before I stood before people to represent God and represent my pastor. And I had to get foundation. It was important to him that we attend Sunday school. It was important to him that I, as a young minister, attended a young people's training union. It was important to him that I, as a minister on his staff, attended Bible class on Tuesday. And let me tell you, for a large part of that, I was playing football. I was going to Poly. And many of you know that I love the school, great, one of the greatest schools in the world, far as I'm concerned. And I went to Poly, I played football, and there were times where I got home from class, from football practice, about 6 o'clock. And I had to turn around and get cleaned up and do as much homework as I could. And then I went to Bible class because my pastor expected me to be there. He did not always expect me on Friday night worship because he knew that we played games many times Friday night. He knew I was playing football and he encouraged me. Okay. because I was faithful in other things, he gave me levity. He gave me freedom in some things as well. But his expectation was for me to be there when he taught so I can get foundation. I would dare say many of the gains I've made in life, and God has blessed me to make many. I don't talk about them all. I'd rather you see them. But I am who I am today because I, by God's grace, was faithful to my man of God to get foundation. Bible class, Sunday school, not always popular things, but it gives you foundation. Can I get a witness? So as a disciple, it is up to us to always gain what we can to get a foundation. Do you hear me? Y'all ministers that are listening to me, people just license. Don't try to get an audience. Get a foundation. Don't try to make a platform for yourself. Make your study room full of resources. Spend time in prayer on your knees before God. Gain a foundation because it's going to give great glory to God when you use mightily of him. But it's going to give great defamation to you. And the enemy will rejoice if he can make you fall, falter, fizzle out, shipwreck. That's less likely when you have foundation. Take the ability to be corrected as giving you foundation. Take the ability to be instructed as giving you foundation. Don't think your man or woman of God is holding you back because they ask you to do things that they want you to do instead of what you want to do, because that's what disciples do. Man, I wish I could talk to young ministers more, because I see a lot of young ministers trying to be like somebody who they have not been experienced enough. What you see on television or when you buy a DVD or listen to a message, many times those messages are edited. I know a lot of people want to preach like Bishop Jakes. Can you bear up under the weight that man bore up under? Can you stay faithful to God when God doesn't necessarily bless you like that? And you got to use diaper bags or diapers for your children or empty bread bags and paper towels. That man experienced that. Poor. But he stayed faithful as a disciple. He got a foundation. Many other men and women of God, you're looking at one who stayed on his face and continues to, who stayed on the word, in the word, and continues to. Because, beloved, that is my foundation. Am I clear? You're going to be an effective disciple. You want to build a strong foundation. So this is the expectation of disciples. Y'all ready? This list is a clarification of expectations. Okay? In order to be a disciple and minister the truth of God through your life. Number one, from the scripture. We read this. I want to make sure I communicate it. A disciple should love the Lord with all their heart, their soul, and their mind. You got to settle the love issue. Do you love praises of men more than God? Do you love platform more than God? Do you love what you perceive as glory more than God? Preaching can be quite exhilarating. Being before people and hearing them respond to you and captivating them could be quite exhilarating. But I'm telling you, if you don't have foundation, you'll be lifted up in pride every time and you will shipwreck. That's why Paul said, you cannot lay hands suddenly on any man, nor can you promote a novice too quickly. They must have time serving to get foundation. And you got to settle the love issue. Do you love God more than, and you fill in the blank? He's got to be the greatest love you've ever known. Hallelujah. Number two, a disciple should love people. How are you going to serve somebody you don't love? How are you going to serve the truth of God when you hate the people of God? Now, I'm going to say something. Don't take it the wrong way, because I'm going to speak very slowly and very clearly. People can take you through various emotional experiences. People, Micah, Mickey, I love you, man. People can take you through stuff that you never dreamed. People are people. And that's what I'm going to say about that. I'm not going to embellish. I'm not going to walk on that anymore. Because then you get into things that you shouldn't say. So I'm going to let my yay be yay and my nay be nay. So I won't say something I shouldn't say about people. But people can challenge you. Though we minister to people, people can challenge you. Though we serve people, people can challenge you. And we all have been challenging at points in our lives and will be a challenge. Can I get a witness? But you got to love people. If you're going to be a disciple, you got to love people. Number three, disciples should put their flesh under subjection of Christ by the power of the Holy Ghost. You got to subdue your flesh. You can't say everything out your mouth you want to say. You can't respond everything you want to respond. You got to be able to be like what the word calls a defense city, like a man who rules their emotions well. You cannot pop off just because somebody pops off at you. You have to be disciplined and be a good disciple and put your flesh under subjection by the Holy Ghost. You cannot put your flesh under subjection by the Holy Ghost who does not fill your life. He'll lead you and guide you into all truth. He does it best from an inside perspective. Man, did I just say that? Yes, I did. The Holy Ghost leads and guides best from an inside perspective. You must be filled with the Holy Ghost. You cannot be submitted to what you have not submitted to. Woo, God, he hot today. You must be filled with the Holy Ghost. Number four, a disciple lives by faith. A disciple does not walk according to what they see, what they hear. They check with God first. I like that definition of faith. I check with God first. How y'all like that? If I'm going to respond, I'm going to respond how God responds. If I'm going to say, man, I feel the Holy Ghost. If I am going to do something, I want to do it by the leading of the Holy Ghost. Because I am a man of faith. Faith come by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. I check with God first. That's how I exercise faith. I hear the word. I believe the word. I obey the word. Then I make adjustments to what I think, to how I see, to what I say, to how I respond based on the word that I hear, I believe, and I obey. Did y'all get that? That's a definition of faith. I know you got rewind. You can go back a little bit on this, but I'll say it again. Faith is the fact that I hear the word, what God said. I believe what God said. I obey what God said. And then I make adjustment to what I say, to how I respond, to how I behave, and how I think based on what God says. That's faith. I check with God first. Disciples live by faith. What does God say? Not what's in the bank. What did God say? Not what's in my pocket. What did God say? Not what they say. Not what she say. Yes, in the multitude of counsel, there's safety. But when God clearly speaks, we counsel with man no more. The question is not, should we? The question, Lord, is how we? When God says do it, we obey him and follow him because he has a plan. And he may not give us all the steps in the beginning, but he'll give you, like my man of God, Ivy Hilliard says, he'll give you more along the way than he does when you first get started. That's a life of faith. Disciples must live by faith. Hallelujah. Then number five, disciples are secure in God's word. That means you got to know God's word and God's love. Can I say that again? A disciple is secure in God's word and in God's love. I know the word because I love the Lord and I know he loves me. You got to know that he loves you. And how do you know he loves you? Because he said so. That should be the primary answer. When somebody wants to know how you know God loves you, that your response should be because he said so. Then you can go off into he shows me every day. I talked to him this morning. He reminded me that he loved me. Come on, somebody. I have a personal, ongoing, vibrant relationship with God. I like that song, The Garden. Here's another hymn. I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. And the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God is calling. And he walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I like that other verse. Can I quote it? He speaks and the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing. And the melody that he gives to me within my heart is ringing. Beloved, you got to love the word and you got to know that God loves you. Again, these five areas to know that are the expectation of disciples. Number one, you ought to love the Lord. You ought to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. You got to love the Lord and you ought to love God's people. Number three, a disciple. Yes, a disciple should put their flesh under subjection by the power and the leading of the Holy Ghost. A disciple, number four, lives by faith. And a disciple is secure in the love of God. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes, they are. A disciple is secure in the love of God. Hallelujah. Y'all get that? Thank you, Lord. And the word of God. Yes, yes. Now, when a disciple, and I'm about to close, lives under the discipline of knowing what is expected, it is not works-based. So don't be thinking, I got to fulfill these expectations. I got to do this. I got to do that. I got to do that other. It's about what I do. No, it's not about what you do. Hear me very closely. You do because you're grateful. I respond to God as a grateful person. And out of a heart of gratitude, I do. Did you hear me? I respond to God as a grateful person. And out of gratitude, I do. I do. Hallelujah. I do not drag my feet on God. I do not withhold myself from God because I'm grateful. I spend time in prayer because I'm grateful. I spend time listening to God, studying his word because I'm grateful. I'm a disciple because I'm grateful. Now, nobody else can say this for me, but I know I can say it for me. Nobody has done for me what the Lord has done for me. I remember an old song we sang, Testimony Service. And we get up and singing, you don't know like I know what he's done for me. And that, by the time we done sang that for about 10 minutes, people that's going forth in the Holy Ghost laugh, dancing and praising God and giving God glory, because nobody can say for you what God means to you. And nobody knows what he means to you like you know. I feel the Holy Ghost up in here. Yeah. So, beloved, you got to understand that it's not works-based, but it's gratitude to the Father for giving us his Son. It is gratitude to the Father for saving us from our sin. What can wash away my sin? Man, I told y'all, y'all better leave me alone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, my God. Woo, Jesus. I serve out of gratitude. Lord, have mercy for the power of God that helps us change for the better from glory to glory. from glory to glory, from glory to glory. I do all of this as a disciple out of gratitude. You don't have to make me do it. I don't have to be threatened or coerced into doing it. I do what I do because I am a grateful brother. I'm a grateful brother. I can't say this enough. He brought me from a mighty long way. Whoa! When I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more, his love lifted me. His grace empowered me. And I'm so in love with Jesus. So what is expected of disciples becomes the least of our offering to God because we are grateful. Can I get you to understand? Lord, help me. Whoa! He's done so much for me. And while I can't tell it all, I sure know it. And I feel it. He's so good. So good. I'm trying to calm myself down because God is showing up good up in here. And I praise his name. So this is lesson number 9, the expectations of disciples. Now, this is part 1. I'll finish up next week with part 2. But beloved, I want to go over these 5 expectations again, the least that I can do, my reasonable service. I got to love the Lord with all my heart and my mind as a disciple that's expected of me. Number 2, a disciple must love God's people. Number 3, a disciple should put their flesh under subjection of Christ by the Holy Ghost. Number 4, a disciple must live by faith. And number 5, a disciple must be secure in the love and the word of God. You go through things, sometimes it make you have questions, but you don't question, does God love you? You don't question, is this word true? Look, don't give in to your feelings, saying stuff and charging God unwisely. You know, we're all tempted to do that. I went through something recently and I was like, God, you hearing me? God, you hear? And I knew he was, but my emotions were getting the best of me for a time until I rallied myself and my wife and others that were there with me. You know, sometimes y'all don't know, us preachers go through things. And I'm not going to give glory to the thing. I give glory to God for bringing me through it. Yeah. Because, beloved, if it had not been for him, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be here. Just because I don't tell the whole story don't mean I'm not going to give God the glory. You know, one of the things as I close that a lot of people want to know is what people have been through, and they want to know your process. And sometimes, can I be honest? Some of us can't handle details. I wish I get one amen. I wish I get one amen. Some of us cannot handle details. Some of us would get thrown off if you knew some of our story. Some of us would never see the present glory because you caught up on the past story. Part of being a disciple is that you understand that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But when you become a disciple, you sin less because his word is hidden in your heart. His word is followed. His word is adhered to. The principles of being a good disciple are followed, and you draw near to God and near to that. Beloved, hear my words. God has great things in store for you, but you cannot follow your flesh if you're a disciple. You got to follow Jesus. Well, in my close, I want to pray for you that you would come under the subjection of the Holy Ghost. Submit your will, your ways, submit your wants, submit your desires, submit it all to Jesus. You can't be a disciple without complete submission to God. What are you holding on to? What are you holding back from him? Is it worth it? I want all God has for me. Can I get a witness? Do you also? Father, I praise you for the word that was given today. This is just part one of the expectations of disciples. Lord, I pray that you would get the glory out of this part one today. And Lord God, feed us today greater than we can ever imagine. Lord, let flesh die. Let flesh be crucified. Let flesh have no part, Lord God, in our advancement, because it can't help us. Lord, we are spirit. We live in this flesh and we have a soul. Lord, you come and fill us with the Holy Ghost. We're not just three parts. Without the Holy Ghost, we're nothing. Lord, you fill us. You walk inside of us. You are Emmanuel, God with us. You are the same Spirit, Holy Ghost, that raised Jesus from the dead. And we submit to you. We submit to you. Now, Father, have your way with this word. And if there be somebody that doesn't know you in the pardon of their sin, draw them to you. Don't let them feel comfortable another second in their sin. Lord, you're not here to condemn them. You're not here to judge them. You're here to bring conviction in order to change them. And Lord, because you love them, you want to bring them out of sin. So Father, let your blood prevail. Let your word be manifested. Let your power be made known. And let us become disciples. Lord God, let somebody today give their heart to you, give their life to you, and turn over to you their very existence so they can live the kind of life you call them to live. You've come, Jesus, that we may have life and live it in abundance to the full, till it overflows. So thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now, Lord, be glorified. And Lord, have your way as you draw people by your loving kindness. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved, if you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, or you want to, contact us. We got three ways to reach us. Way number one, 443-776-0255. 443-776-0255. Then we have our email. That's lbcministry@yahoo.com. lbcministry@yahoo.com. Then we have, by God's grace, our email and our website. You can contact through email by our website. That's lbcbaltimore.org. You're about to see a brand new website coming real soon. September going to be full of new things coming out of Light Builders Church, coming out of Pastor Allen Bishop, coming out of you. Get ready for it. We're just going to let God do the talking, but you get the glory, Father. But I just want to tease September because we've arrived to August. So, beloved, be blessed today because you got to admit you need him. I need you to admit you need him. Then you got to believe in him. He is the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And Jesus died to save you. He did. And he loves you. You got to commit to follow him. That's what disciples do. We commit to follow the Lord. Now, beloved, want to hear from you. Look, this Sunday is our last worship for this year at Pikesville High School. Unless something changes, we won't be at Pikesville anymore after this first Sunday. This first Sunday, Pikesville High School will be there at 10 a.m. It's on the corner of Smith Avenue and Labyrinth Road. Labyrinth Road, 7611, I believe it is, on Labyrinth Road in Pikesville, Maryland. We'll be there at 10 a.m. I'm praying that all be ready to receive you. I'm praying that somebody greets you at the door with a smile on their face. I'm praying that somebody shows you you can get a good seat. We have plenty of space for those that are uncomfortable, but I want to see everybody. Some of y'all have been listening to us, and you've never attended a live worship of Life Builders Church. This is the last opportunity at Pikesville High School that you will have to do that. Why? I'll tell you why soon. God is so good. God is so good. Whoa, God is so good. Well, beloved, we got to go. Don't forget our offering for August. Offering for August is our consecrated life building 40-day devotional. The description box, you can get it off of Amazon. And you can really, you don't have to wait for us. You can go on this 40-day journey and consecrate your life. I tell you, many have been blessed by this, and I want you to join the ranks of the blessed. Well, beloved, God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Notice this is not the actual one. This is a manuscript because I sold out and gave the last one to my mama. So, beloved, I don't have any more. I'm going to order some more. I got some books on back order because God has been blessing. People have been buying, and I appreciate it. Well, beloved, we leave you now. We invite you to join us, if you can, live Sunday morning, Pikesville High School, 10 a.m. in Pikesville, Maryland, again at the corner of Smith Avenue and Labyrinth Road. If you cannot join us live, join us over this venue that will be online, Facebook Live, amen, will be on. Also, you can get the information as to our Zoom coordinates. We'll give you that if you call us and write us, and we'll give you that. Don't miss this Sunday's worship. There's a powerful word in store. I tell you, God's going to be in the midst. Well, we got to go. You be blessed and know that God is good and he's faithful and awesome all by himself. Love you. I'm